Okay, we are starting Acts 24. Got a presentation for you guys, but you're not going to see it. So, make sure my computer doesn't fall out of there. All right.
Oh, I'm going to get close. Holy moly. I thought I was going to get close.
Instead, I'm going to hurt you. Huh? Oh, I forgot about the camera. Man.
Hi.
All right, come on. Everybody, welcome Denny. Woo! Hey, Denny, woohoo! All right. We are starting Acts 24, which is not in the book of John. As Pastor Jim finished up last week of 23, we find Paul being whisked away to Caesarea. Sorry, I drew a blank there. He went to Jerusalem, much against the recommendation of his friends, much against the prayers and requests, and in the spirit they warned, and yet he went anyway. There was a pact amongst the Jewish leaders there, a fasting pact that we're not gonna eat again until we kill this guy. If you're fasting, that's generally not a good target to kill somebody. I'm not eating again until I kill this guy. So that's a free tip. I mean, I don't know that I can find a verse for that, but that's generally a good tip. Don't fast until you kill somebody, including yourself. Not a good idea. But they had this pact. They wanted Paul dead. He had, in their mind, caused lots of ruckus, caused lots of harm. He was spreading this way, this sect they didn't like. So they collapsed on him, desiring to take care of him. The commander heard word of it, and they whisked him away first to Antipatris, and then on to Caesarea, and so it's when he gets there, Felix, the governor, sees him, but for the night he just sticks him in the, talks to him, says, well, we're gonna wait till your accusers get here, sticks him in the Praetorium, Herod's Praetorium, which is basically his palace, for like governor's house, palace, whatever, for lack of a better term. It was nice accommodations. It wasn't necessarily or rough accommodations. We'll find out later in chapter 24 that Felix, who was the governor at this time, had some familiarity with the way, with Christianity, and with a good, fairly accurate understanding. And so we're going to read chapter 24. We're going to cover the whole chapter tonight, and then we will discuss it a bit. Chapter 24, verse 1. Now after 5 days, Ananias the high priest came down, and the elders and a certain orator named Tertullus. These gave evidence to the governor against Paul, governor's against Felix. And when he was called upon, Tertullus began his accusation, saying, seeing that through you we enjoy great peace and prosperity is being brought to this nation by your foresight, we accept it always and in all places, most noble Felix, with all thankfulness. Nevertheless, not to be tedious to you any further, I beg you to hear by your courtesy a few words from us. For we have found this man a plague, a creator of dissension among all Jews throughout the world, a ringleader of the sect of the Nazarenes. He even tried to profane the temple, and we seized him and wanted to judge him according to our law. But the commander, Lysias, came by and with great violence took him out of our hands, commanding his accusers to come to you. By examining him yourself, you may ascertain all these things of which we accuse him. And the Jews also assented, maintaining that these things were so. Then Paul, after the governor had nodded to him to speak, answered, "Inasmuch as I know that you have been for many years a judge of this nation, I do the more cheerfully answer for myself, because you may ascertain that it is no more than 12 days since I went up to Jerusalem to worship. And they neither found me in the temple disputing with anyone, nor inciting the crowd, neither in the synagogues, nor in the city, nor can they prove the things of which they now accuse me. But this I confess to you, that according to the way which they call a sect, I worship the God of my fathers, believing all things which are written in the law and in the prophets. I have hope in God, which they themselves also accept, that there will be a resurrection of the dead, both of the just and the unjust. This being so, I myself always strive to have a conscience without offense towards God and men. Now after many years, I came to bring alms and offerings to my nation, in the midst of which some Jews from Asia found me purified in the temple, neither with a mob nor with tumult. They ought to have been here before you to object if they had anything against me. Or else let those who were here themselves say if they found any wrongdoing in me while I stood before the council. Unless it is for this one statement which I cried out, standing among them concerning the resurrection of the dead, I am being judged by you this day." And if you remember Pastor Jim bringing that up, that he, when he noticed that the people at the council were Sadducees and Pharisees, he threw this bomb out there, "Hey, resurrection of the dead," stood back, and they kind of started fighting, and then he got to get out of there. And that's kind of what he points. I wonder, sitting here as he's got, you know, the people who are accusing him again, if he's trying to, let's throw this bomb one more time, see if we can get them to act foolish again. But anyway, unless it is for the one statement which I cried out, standing among them, concerning the resurrection of the dead, I am being judged by you this day. But when Felix heard these things, having more accurate knowledge of the way, he adjoined the proceedings and said, "When Lysias the commander comes down, I will make a decision on your case." So he commanded the centurion to keep Paul and to let him have liberty, and hold him, and told him not to forbid any of his friends to provide for or visit him. And after some days, when Felix came with his wife Drusilla, who was Jewish, he sent for Paul and heard him concerning the faith in Christ. Now as he reasoned about righteousness, self-control, and the judgment to come, Felix was afraid and answered, "Go away for now. When I have a convenient time, I will call for you." Meanwhile, he also hoped that money would be given him by Paul, that he might release him. Therefore, he sent for him more often and conversed with him. But after 2 years, Porcius Festus succeeded Felix, and Felix, wanting to do the Jews a favor, left Paul bound. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you, God, for your word. We thank you, God, for as we read this narrative in Paul's life of the events leading up to his death, God, may you teach us more about you, more about your way, more about following you. God, we thank you for Paul's example. Lord, loving his accusers, loving whom he stands under judgment from, loving all those around him, God, for your glory. Lord, help us to live that way. God, we ask you, Lord, to transform our hearts. God, we love you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, this is going to be very, very simplified. So if you are highly skilled in the ways of debate and all those things, you're going to go, "That's not totally accurate." I know. This is a very simplified idea that I'm trying to give you. So there's a kind of a basic breakdown of of when you're trying to convince somebody of something. There's a rhetorical and there's a dialectic. The rhetorical is using facts, using logic, using logical constructs to construct an argument that you can then convince somebody of the truth. Rhetoric, the rhetorical argumentation, is you're trying to tap into an emotion and get an emotional response. Just about all of this presidential election cycle was all about rhetoric. We got very little policy, tapping into things that really matter. We're just, she's this, he's that, blah, 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 rhetoric. Tap into emotion. How do I feel about this? And that makes me feel yucky, So this is kind of and our culture is very boiled in rhetoric. There's very little thinking that goes on anymore in our culture, and that's just a simple fact. And so it becomes important. Why does this matter? Why are we starting this way? We see here they come out, not with great arguments, not with much evidence, but they pick themselves a good lawyer, and he's a great speaker. And he starts with, "Oh, glorious Felix, oh, the great one who are so wonderful and have led us in peace and all your wisdom and blah, 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 blah," right? So he comes out with all sorts of feathery rhetoric, not because they have a good case against, because A, this guy, this is bald-faced lies. If you look in the history of who Felix was, there were insurrection after insurrection against him that he put down in very cruel and harsh ways. This is just pure lies. They're just saying this stuff to make him feel good and to hopefully bend his ear to their sides. What do you say? Yeah. Yeah. So hopefully to bend his ear to their sides. So that's why I'm starting with this idea of rhetoric versus dialectic. Because the reality in our culture, in all cultures, there are going to be people that respond to rhetorical speech and respond to dialectic speech. And it's our job as followers of Christ to listen within a conversation. If we go into a conversation talking to somebody about Christ and we're just blah, 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 whatever I want to say, these are my 10 things I say when I talk to somebody about Jesus, rather than listening, we take a good chance on missing the language this person speaks. And I'm not talking about, does he speak English or Spanish or something else? I'm talking about, does he speak dialectic? Give him logical arguments and he can respond and change his mind? Or does he think and speak rhetorically? Do you need to bring him the gospel, bring her the gospel in an couched, and we don't change the gospel, but how we deliver the gospel can be suited to the person we're talking to. Do they speak rhetoric? We couch it in a emotionally viable vehicle. Do they speak dialectic? But then we can go to the history. We can go to the biblical narrative. Absolutely, we can bring out logic. We can lay out an argument, and they may be convinced. And does that desire? I'm not taking the Holy Spirit out of the mix. Understand that, but we can tailor our approach to people based on who they are, and so we must listen. So here we are, and I'm just pulling this out because I felt like the Lord wanted me to pull it out, is to listen. It requires us to listen to people when we talk to them of Christ. Make sure you're listening. Find out how they react to things. Find out how they think about things. Are they an emotional thinker? The fact is, our culture, with all the drama that we see on TV and all the junk we and our kids grew up on, we're almost exclusively rhetorical thinkers, rhetorical speakers. We react to how we feel and how things make us feel. Be aware of that. So if you're just coming to somebody with a, here's the logical facts, they're absolutely logical and factual, but they're going to be like, man, that makes me feel weird. But it's the truth. But I feel like, but so be aware of that when you're speaking to someone. Life lesson, if you're speaking to someone who speaks, learns in rhetorically, you should bring the gospel to them in that language. If you're speaking to someone who speaks, learns dialectically, you should bring the gospel to them in that language. And so, I had a slide that I wanted to share that I don't actually have in my, I'm going to pull it up just because I want to, the idea, and just to give you a kind of feel for what I mean, rhetorical is easy. It's going to be racist, sexist, this guy's stupid, these are throwing out, you know, got nothing based in fact, just throwing out stuff to make you feel, well, I don't like racists, well, I don't like sexists, well, I don't like, you know, that makes me feel, so therefore I can't think beyond that. You know, the dialectic then is the construction of an actual argument. Well, just throw out something from the Bible. That, well, why, you know, we had very scared disciples. Jesus died. Something happened. Something, and then 3 days later, something happened, and all of a sudden, you had very brave disciples. But what is this thing that happened? You're constructing an argument of why. What was this? We have a narrative of how they acted before Jesus died and rose again. We have a narrative of how he acted after. The question at hand is was the resurrection of Christ real? Well, something certainly mind-blowing, mind-changing, heart-changing happened right there. And so that's kind of a feel of a dialectic argument that you can make. Something based on history, fact, logic, those type of things. Make sense? Tracking? Okay, cool. Enough of that. So why do I bring that out here? Because this is what they did. They brought out a rhetorical speaker, somebody who's going to speak to this guy. And you know, this guy is, Felix, is known for taking bribes. We're going to find out later. He's all about, give me a little money, super, very corrupt. He was a slave. He was a slave who became the governor of this area. Could be called a king, and kings weren't necessarily the top guy always in this era. They could be kings of different regions and whatnot. And so he became a ruler based on some connections he had with his brother. He was from a slave to a ruler, and it was said of him that he ruled with a slave's mentality. He was very hard. He was, you know, never trusted anybody. He was always very kind of vicious towards people, and. He was not. He was not. He was Roman. His wife was Jewish. Huh?
He was a slave.
Yes. Yeah. Correct. His wife was Jewish. Well, this wife that you find in here, Drusilla, this is actually his second wife named Drusilla. And I would suspect, I didn't read into it, but if you look into that era, names didn't necessarily, they kind of followed positions a lot. Not necessarily this was really his name that he was given at birth. So I think going back to Drusilla, his wife, who was Jewish. This was his second wife named Drusilla. I would suspect that name followed whoever was married to him, but we're just going with that. Did I answer your question? Okay. Okay, so, read. Now after 5 days, Ananias the high priest came down with the elders and a certain orator named Tertullius. These gave evidence to the governor against Paul. And here's the evidence they supposedly gave. And when he was called upon, Tertullius began his accusation, saying, seeing that though through you we enjoy great peace and prosperity, whatever, is being brought to this nation by your foresight. And we accept it always and in all places, most noble Felix, and with all thankfulness. Nevertheless, not to be tedious to you any further, I beg you to hear by your courtesy a few words from us. For we have found this man a plague, a creator of dissension among the Jews throughout the world, and a ringleader of the sect of Nazarenes. He tried to profane the temple, and we seized him, and wanted to judge him according to the law. But the commander, anybody got a proper enunciation for that pronunciation? Lysias. Lysias came by and with great violence took him out of our hands, commanding his accusers to come to you. By examining him yourself, you may ascertain all these things of which we accused him. They didn't accuse him really of any. He's a bad guy. He's a plague. That plague guy. And he's a creator of dissension. Thinking of the history of Felix, who has had to put down several dissensions. I know this guy I'm speaking to. He's had to put down several dissensions, and he's had to do it very harsh, or he has done it harshly. I'm pushing an emotional button with Felix. Dissension. This guy's a plague and a creator of dissension, and so there's no evidence to anything he's giving. He's just saying, you know, pushing an emotional button here. Creator. Interestingly, though, Tertullius plays a compliment to Paul, not on purpose. Creator of dissension among the Jews throughout the world. Throughout the world. That's a oops, let that slip. I mean, Paul's like, yeah, sweet. Throughout the whole world, praise the Lord. I have helped spread this sect. I'm a ringleader of this sect. So this is probably not something that Paul at all thinks badly of. Praise the Lord. I've been used to touch the world. And I guess the point I just kind of want to bring out here is, how do you act? How do you talk to? How do you respond to people that you feel like can do something for you? Whether they're rich, whether they hold a position of power, whether they have a skill that sure would be handy. They've got a skill, I've got a job that meets that skill. How do I talk to this person to get them to do something for me? They wanted a ruling against Paul. And so they're poking the buttons, they're manipulating, they're doing what they can to this Felix to get him to rule the way they want. And so I guess my question just for you, for me, is how do you act around those whom you think can benefit you? How do you act? Do you try to get something from someone? Do you just treat them the same way? What about somebody who you don't think can help you? They really don't have any skills you can use. They don't have any, they're poor, they're dirty, they're smelly, whatever. How do you automatically act towards them? And it's a good, you know, being honest, we're human. We have a reaction towards that. And it's good to be aware of it, huh? Yes. Can be, should be. Are we a blessing to those? Romans 16:18. For those who are such do not serve the Lord Jesus, but their own belly, and by smooth words and flattering speech deceive the hearts of the simple. Jude 1:16. These are grumblers, complainers, walking according to their own lusts, and they mouth great swelling words, flattering people to gain advantage. Show no partiality. So this is when somebody can give you something potentially that you would like from them. Be careful. Do you fall into flattery? It's easy. I mean, I've absolutely done it in my life. It's easy when you see somebody that can do something for you to be a flatterer. And then maybe you don't, as a leader in the church or as a or just a brother in Christ, maybe you don't talk to them about something. You see sin that you maybe ought to speak to, but if I say something, I might not get the thing that I'm hoping to get from them. So I just hold my tongue. So beware. James 2:2-4. For if there should come into your assembly a man with gold rings and fine apparel, and there should also come in a poor man in filthy clothes, and you pay attention to the one wearing the fine clothes and say to him, you sit here in a good place, and say to the poor man, you stand there or sit here on my footstool. Have you not shown partiality among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? What's that evil thought? I think that's part of it. It's also self-seeking. It's yes, that evil thought there is not no longer judging the situation, no longer caring for the individual, but instead you've, ding, there's something I can gain out of this. And now, how do I treat that person? Acts 10:34. Then Peter opened his mouth and said, in truth I perceive that God shows no partiality. If we're going to have a heart like God, a heart like Jesus, we should show no partiality. And that goes both ways, to be honest. In our culture, there can be an ideal. I'll say how it's, I've even uttered the words, just you know, shocking, I know. I'm a sinner. But that about, you know, I was involved, this is years ago now, I don't remember who else I was involved with, but we were talking about a neighborhood to go into for door-to-door evangelism. We're not going to go to the rich neighborhood, they're fine, we're going to go to the poor neighborhood. You know, I'm showing partiality against wealthy people, because they got it all together. They're not going to want to hear what we got to say. I mean, seriously, that's just as evil as showing, you know, showing favoritism towards poor versus favoritism towards what? That's, both are just as evil. That was the last time I sinned, though, just FYI. I can't remember any since then. Thank you. Romans 2:11 in the King James. For there is no respect of persons in God. This was Felix. Let me read, actually. Sorry. Down. Then Paul, after the governor had nodded to him to speak, answered, inasmuch as I know that you have been for many years a judge of this nation. He speaks truth. He doesn't, nothing flattering. He speaks truth. I know you've been a judge of this nation, period. I do the more cheerfully, I'll be glad to answer for myself. I do the more cheerfully answer for myself, because you may ascertain that is no more than 12 days since I went up to Jerusalem to worship. I went there for my 7 days of purification for worship. Now I've been here for 5 days. They dragged me up here, been 5 days, 12 days. And they neither found me in the temple disputing with anyone, nor inciting the crowd, either in the synagogues or in the city, nor can they prove the things of which they now accuse me. But this I confess to you, that according to the way, and I love this, here's Paul's on the stand. This is his chance to, you know, lay out the evidence, but instead he's like, you know what, I'm going to say a few words, but then I'm just going to give you the gospel. I'm just going to make sure you hear a chunk of the gospel right here. That's, man, do we take those opportunities. But this I confess to you, that according to the way which they call a sect, I worship the God of my fathers, believing all things that are written in the law and the prophets. I have hope in God. He's confessing to his hope in God, which they themselves also accept. And then he speaks of the resurrection, that there will be a resurrection of the dead, both of the just and the unjust. This being so, I myself always strive to have conscience without offense towards God and men. Now, after many years, I came to bring alms and offerings to my nation, in the midst of which some Jews from Asia found me purified in the temple, neither with a mob nor with tumult. There was neither a bunch of people gathered, nor was there a bunch of mess going on. They ought to have been here before you to object if they had anything against me. The Jews from Asia, he's talking about. Or else let those who are here themselves say if they found any wrongdoing in me while I stood before the council. Unless it is for this one statement which I cried out, standing among them, concerning the resurrection, if the dead of the dead, I am being judged by you this day. Sorry, that was what he said before the council. Concerning the resurrection of the dead, I am being judged by you this day. But Felix, so Paul gives his little spiel. Most of it's the gospel. Most of it's pointing to his hope in God and the future of a resurrection, and the fact that he's came down to be a blessing to the people in Jerusalem, to bring to offerings and alms. So Felix, having heard both sides, but then Felix heard these things, having more accurate knowledge of the way, he adjourned the proceedings and said, pause there, having a more accurate knowledge of the way. So he was given one view of the way. He was given a plague, a creator of decision. He's a ringleader of the sect, all negative. He was given this one view, but he knew differently. And we don't know who, somebody had been living the gospel, sharing the gospel in his life. And I just wonder, for myself, and for you guys to think, is that the case at work? Is that the case for your managers, for the people you work with, the people who serve you? Do they know have a more accurate understanding of the way, so that then when they hear something on the History Channel or they hear something on the news about how Christian this or Christian that, they're like, no, but I know Denny, and I know Steve Kyle. I know a more accurate understanding of the way because I've seen it lived out in front of me. And somebody had lived it out in front of him, and so he knew a more accurate understanding of the way. And so because of that, because of what he heard, Paul said, I'm part of the way. He said, I know followers of Christ, and they don't act this way. These aren't the people that cause dissension. These aren't the people who I've had to put down. So he knew a more accurate, that doesn't mean we find out he didn't come to Christ. He didn't accept that. But the seed had been planted, the understanding had been planted by somebody who'd lived out their walk in front of them. But when Felix heard these things, having a more accurate knowledge of the way, he adjourned the proceedings. He said, enough, I've heard enough. And said, when Lysias, the commander, comes down, I will make a decision on your case. And this is the commander from Jerusalem that had him sent up by night to protect him, which they tried to throw under the bus up here, by the way. But the commander, Lysias, came by and with great violence took him out of our hands. They tried to throw him under the bus. Well, let me hear from him, see what he has to say. And so he commanded the centurion to keep Paul and let him have liberty, let him have freedom, and told him not to forbid any of his friends to provide for or visit him. It's obvious that Felix, he likes and agrees and knows that Paul is not guilty of the stuff he's accused of. He's giving him much liberty, allowing his friends to care for and visit him, giving him lots of freedom. However, if he knows this, the question being, why hasn't he set him free? And I think the reality is he probably has something political, something monetary, something I can gain. Yeah, I agree, he's not probably done what... obviously, this is conjecture, but he's seeing something he can gain from keeping him here. Because we don't know. That's conjecture, but we never hear that Lysias ever even comes. And he certainly doesn't make the judgment on the case. So, you know, because he's in prison for two more years until, you know, Felix gets replaced. And so does Lysias never come? Is he never called? Does he just not make the judgment like he said he would? Whatever. Felix has decided there's something I can get out of this. And after some days, when Felix came with his wife, Drusilla, who was Jewish, he sent for Paul and heard him concerning the faith in Christ. And so Paul then, he gets a chance. He gets a chance in front of his second wife, Drusilla. She's a Jew. We don't know if he brings her there to hear the gospel too, because he's got his interest piqued. We don't know. We don't know if he brings her there to get some, you know, to get her counsel on this guy. Felix was known for a lot of licentious living, loose living. Drusilla was married to someone else. They had adultery. He took her away from him. This next verse here. Now he reasoned about righteousness, self-control, judgment to come. Paul's aware of the people he's speaking to, and he's not shying away from what they need to hear. There's righteousness, self-control, judgment to come. He's speaking to Felix and his wife, who have not been righteous, have not been self-controlled. And then when he talks about the judgment to come, Felix is afraid. He's like, ooh, that doesn't sound like I want to hear any more about that. So he sends him away. Go away for now when I have a convenient time for you. I will call for you. And so again, I wonder, and I, thinking on my own heart, and for you guys to consider, are there areas of your life that you're waiting for obedience for a convenient time? That God has called you to something, called you to do something, and you're waiting for a convenient time. Am I waiting for a convenient time? The Holy Spirit works on us. He gives us opportunities. He gives, this is obviously a salvation moment for Felix and his wife. We find out later, historical means, his wife, Drusilla, she died in Pompeii with the famous eruption. She's one of the people of note who died in that. Did she ever respond? We don't know. Probably not. We can hope she heard the gospel. It was planted. The seed was planted. But then not necessarily, I can't assume, but most likely all of you guys are saved, have already put your faith in Christ. But what about other steps of obedience? Is there any areas that you're waiting for a convenient time to set some sin down, to do something the Lord's told you? Felix tries to walk a middle ground here. He tries to kind of be friendly with Paul and not necessarily come against what Paul is saying, but he's not willing to submit his life to Christ. He's not willing to hear and accept what Paul is saying. And I'm just blessed that, I mean, Paul is in this position loving on this dude. He wants him to know the truth. He's not trying to get himself out of prison. He's not trying to help himself. He wants Felix and Drusilla to meet Jesus. And so he goes to their sin and says, look, man, Jesus is coming, and you got this issue in your life. Jesus is coming. Go away for now. When I have a convenient time, I will call for you. Meanwhile, he also hoped. I'm going to quote here real quick, actually. Thou sayest another time, how knowest thou that thou wilt ever feel again as thou feelest now? This morning, perhaps a voice is saying in thy heart, prepare to meet thy God. Tomorrow that voice will be hushed. The gaieties of the ballroom, the theater, will put out that voice that warns thee now, and perhaps thou wilt never hear it again. Men all have their warnings, and all men who perish will have had a last warning. Perhaps this is your last warning. Spurgeon. Meanwhile, he also hoped that money would be given him by Paul, that he might release him. Therefore, he sent for him often and conversed with him. But after 2 years, Porcius Festus succeeded Felix, and Felix, wanting to do the Jews a favor, left Paul bound. And I think we see Felix's reason for keeping him around. He wanted money, if not money, political favor with the Jews, because he wouldn't. And Paul was just using this thing. All right, if you want money from me, I'll just keep sharing the gospel with you. I'll just keep. We'll converse. And I have no doubt that Paul kept bringing the truth to him every time he met. What are you trying to get from Jesus? Felix had an opportunity here. We don't know. I haven't read his history. So I don't know beyond this point. I haven't read his history. I don't know if he ever accepted Christ. But I think we have a tendency with Jesus to try to get something from him, as Felix was trying to get something. He had an ulterior motive in what he could get from Paul rather than Christ. And I think sometimes we have an ulterior motive that sneaks in there, not necessarily as blatant as give me some money, or as blatant as, but we have, you know, God, I had worked out in my mind this is how it was supposed to work, and it didn't work out that way. Whether it be a job, whether it be a spouse that's lost, whether it be a child that's lost, whatever, God, I had this. This is what I called you to do. This, Lord, I wanted this. And so, what are we trying to get from Jesus? Or is he truly our Lord? Or are we trying to get something from him? He offers much. He has many promises. He has many, many gifts that he gives us. But first we must set ourselves down, set our even good desires, if they're desires that we raise up over our desire to glorify Christ, they become a desire that needs to be taken care of. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you again for your word, Lord. I pray, Lord, for these men and for my own heart, God, that you would humble us, Lord. Make us aware of areas, Lord, where we are seeking you for what you can give us rather than for who you are and what you've already done. God, I ask you to bless these men. Lord, if there are any here who don't know you, have not truly put their faith in you, God, I pray, Lord, that you would make them aware of it right now, God, that they're dealing with you as though you're going to do something that they want for their flesh. God, I pray, Lord, you would root that out of them, make it clear that they need you still, and bring them to their knees. Lord, thank you for this time. In Jesus' name, amen.